President Cordero, I just wanted to remind you that Revelation 21:8 says liars are cast in the lake of fire. Only I could get away with that. Well, graduates of the class of 2011, President Cordero, distinguished faculty, administrators, and staff, parents, grandparents, family, guests, pastors, and former presidents of this college, like Dr. Don Bryan, who is here, on whose shoulders we stand, former deans, and any others that are here that I've not had a chance to meet or greet. It is a distinct honor to be here this evening to address you on this very significant day. Thank you for allowing me to share in this capstone event of the academic year and in the history of New Hope Christian College. Now, I want to be sure that there's no misunderstanding about what I mean when I say this significant evening, because I'm really not talking about the field of finalists on American Idol tonight, for those of you that follow that, nor am I talking about the National Day of Prayer, which is today. Intercessors all across America are crying out to God, praying and fasting about the future of this nation, asking God to send a spiritual awakening. And neither am I talking about Mother's Day, which comes in just a few days. So a blessed and happy Mother's Day to all of you that are here. Of course, I am talking about you, for your achievement and your perseverance and your hard work and all that crowns you on this very special evening. I've had the opportunity to speak at several commencement addresses, and what I have discovered, I actually did a little survey one time, and I contacted 20 college graduates and asked them if any of them remembered what the commencement speaker talked about, and not one of them did, because the party is really not about me in this address. It's really about you and what you've accomplished. But I do have a word from the Lord that I want to bring you this evening. And I want to be the first to congratulate you for graduating and staying the course. I want to read to you a little passage of scripture from Deuteronomy chapter 32, beginning with verse 9. It says, "For the Lord's portion is his people." That's a mouthful, isn't it? The Lord's inheritance, the Lord's portion is his people. He found him in a desert land, a barren and howling waste, and shielded his people and cared for them and guarded them as the apple of his eye. And then it says, "Like an eagle that stirs up its nest and hovers over its young and spreads its wings to catch them and carries them on its pinions, so the Lord alone did lead them." I want tonight to ask you, graduates of the class of 2011, to consider the eagle. Now, why would I do that? Well, it's very interesting. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 20, a passage you may very well be familiar with, we read in the NIV version that what may be known about God can be understood from what is made or what is created. So nature assists in the revelation of God. We can look at things made or things created, and we can better discern God and understand God. Perhaps that's why Elihu said to Job in Job 37, "Stand still and consider the wondrous works of God." Or maybe that's why Solomon wrote, "Go to the ant and consider her ways." Or maybe that's why Matthew wrote, "Consider the lilies of the field." Or perhaps it's why Dr. Luke wrote, "Consider the ravens." Well, I don't want to talk to you this evening about the heavens or the ant or the lilies or the ravens. I want to talk to you about the eagle. Consider the eagle tonight, because the Holy Spirit in Scripture uses it to speak to his people. Of 34 references to the eagle in Scripture, most of them refer to the very notable golden eagle, the eastern species, a large, powerful bird of prey called by men the king of the fowls. It's an imposing bird. A mature adult will weigh on average about 20 pounds. From his beak to the end of his tail feathers might be up to 5 feet. And his wingspan, an almost unbelievable 7.5 to 8 feet. The height of a normal ceiling is 8 feet. This king of the skies has emerged as a symbol of leadership in almost every civilization that has preceded us. Empires have long given prominence and esteem to the eagle: Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome. Every soldier's shield in the Roman army had an eagle on it. Native American culture has esteemed the eagle. In our own United States, it's on our national symbol and our emblem. The eagle has even been distinguished by God as being one of the four faces on the living creatures in Ezekiel's vision. So tonight, I would ask you to consider the eagle. Four characteristics that are instructive to Christian leaders specifically and set high standards to which eagle leaders should aspire. And I believe that they are prophetic and give direction for us in this hour for sons and daughters of the living God. Consider the eagle. First, the eagle's sight. Millenniums ago, Job spoke of the eagle's sight when he wrote this: "The eagle mounts up at your command. It spies out its prey. Its eyes observe from afar." Graduates, the kingdom of God does not advance by might. It advances by sight, by spiritual vision that sees afar off. Spiritual vision, sight that sees around the corner or over the horizon when you haven't been there. By active faith that sees things that are not as though they actually are. You see, the eagle's eye is almost as large as your eye, as a human eye. The difference is that the eagle's eye has two centers of focus instead of one. The eagle can actually see straight ahead and to the side at exactly the same time. Its vision is four times sharper than that of a 20/20 perfect vision. An eagle can actually fly at an altitude of 1,000 feet over open country, and over a period of 3 square miles can spot motion and see its prey. At 1,000 feet, an eagle can see a mile away and see the movement of a mouse, because it has the ability to extend its eye and retract its eye just like the zoom lens on a camera. Graduates, consider the eagle, says the Lord, for the eye observes from afar. He sees things far away, things that no one else sees, but the eye of faith embraces it. I believe that the currency of the kingdom of God is active faith, which according to Hebrews 11:1 says that we can be certain of things that we do not see. That's an oxymoron, isn't it? How is that possible, to be certain of things that we do not see? And yet it actually happens. We see things from afar. Our spirit sees it as reality before it comes to pass. In 1988, I was the president of a Kansas corporation that had 17 offices across the state. We had just received an award of excellence from President Ronald Reagan for a public-private partnership that we were doing in the area. I had served in that organization where I was for 11 years. I was on my knees in my basement office praying, and I had just heard that the vacancy for the president of Eugene Bible College, that there was a vacancy for the presidency of Eugene Bible College. I had also just completed my master's degree. And while on my knees praying, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, reverberated me. I exploded in a pool of tears, and in an instant of time, as presumptuous as it may sound, and I don't intend it to be arrogant or presumptuous, I knew that we would be putting our house up for sale and relocating to Eugene, Oregon. The board of directors had not received a resume from me at that time. I'm not sure that anybody on the board even knew me. I hadn't been interviewed. But you see, the kingdom of God advances not by might, but by sight, by spiritual vision. Consider Abraham. John wrote about it in John chapter 8, verse 56. Now, you and I know that Abraham, I don't know how many thousands of years, we'd have to ask one of our Old Testament scholars, but let's say 5 or 6,000 years B.C., and in John 8, 56, it says, "Our father Abraham," Jesus was speaking, he said, "Our father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." That spiritual vision that saw beyond all those millenniums of time, the eagle sees afar off. So do God's leaders, just like the heroes of faith in the Hall of Fame. It says in Hebrews 11:3 that they saw the promises of God afar off, and they were persuaded of them, and they embraced them and confessed them. And so I want to ask you this evening, what have you seen? What do you see in your spirit, your spiritual vision? The kingdom of God advances not by might, but by sight. Consider the eagle, says the Lord. I put a vision in you, a lofty dream in you, a word in you. Have you been afraid to embrace it? Does it seem too impossible, even though God specializes in the impossible? See beyond the veil. Natural might means nothing. Let faith's sight take you into your calling and your destiny. The eagle is also known for its strength, legendary strength. The eagle can lift a log 9 feet long, 4 inches in diameter. When it's finished, it becomes the building blocks of its nest or its home. When it's finished, it will have built a nest that weighs between 1 to 2 tons, and it can withstand wind force and gales of up to 100 miles per hour. Because you see, the eagle's strength lies not in its legs, but in its wings. Its strength is in flight, not in might. The kingdom of God advances not by might, but by flight. God, the strong one, the omnipotent one, the mighty one, lifts and carries. Graduates, when you are weary and worn out and it's time to quit pushing and pulling, it's not going to be might that will help you. It will be flight. The Father lifted the Son, and the Son lifts you and carries you on eagle's wings to himself. The eagle carries its sons and its daughters as God carries his people. It says in Exodus 19:4, you have seen what I did, how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. You've heard the dream. I know you have. It was written in 1936 by Mary Stevenson, but it might serve us well to hear it again. One night I dreamed I was walking along the beach with the Lord, and in each scene I noticed footprints in the sand. There were always two sets of footprints, but at other times there was only one. This bothered me because I noticed that during the low periods of my life, when I was suffering from anguish, sorrow, or defeat, I could only see one set of footprints. So I said to the Lord, you promised me, Lord, that if I followed you, you would walk with me always. But I have noticed that during the most trying periods of my life, there's only been one set of footprints in the sand. Why, when I needed you most, have you not been there for me? And the Lord replied, when you have seen only one set of footprints, my child, is when I carried you. Because you see, the Lord's portion is his people, and he carries us on his wings. I spent a decade in scouting. After achieving the rank of eagle on my final trip as an explorer scout, we trained and prepared for 7 days to go in the wilderness on a canoeing adventure into the Canadian boundary waters north of Minnesota. Back in those days, there were no public campgrounds at all, just endless miles of pristine wilderness, waterways, islands, and what a canoeer knows as a portage. I hear some chuckles. A portage means that you carry on your backs everything in your possession over distances, in our case, ranging from an eighth of a mile to well over half a mile. Canoes, paddles, field packs, tents, bedrolls, food, cooking gear, fishing equipment, everything. Up and down hills and over rocky terrain, we carried all of those things, but we carried one more thing. We carried Mike. As a boy, Mike had been severely disabled in his legs from polio. He was as thin and as brittle as a toothpick. I will never forget Mike. He wore heavy steel braces on his legs that were so thick and so heavy that you couldn't imagine he could even walk with them. He struggled to do so. Mike wanted to go on this trip, but there was no way that he could do it unless, of course, he was carried. And that's what we did. 25 miles in, 25 miles out, we carried Mike. And that's what the eagle does with his sons and his daughters. On eagle's wings, he carries them. God wants to carry you. He expects to carry you. To the weak, to the weary, to the tired, to the discouraged. The Spirit says, rest. Allow yourself to be carried. It's okay to be carried. It's all right. This is not an exhortation to quit working or to cease activity. Rather, it's a call to release the burden of work and remove the weight. Stress be gone in Jesus' name. You see, the strength of the eagle, demonstrating the Lord's power to both lift and to carry, is a harbinger of God's promise to do another thing, and that's to renew you. In nature, the eagle is transformed by renewal, giving it the appearance of youth. I know everyone would love to discover the fountain of youth, to remain forever young, to be agile, to be strong, no wrinkles, you know, not lose your memory, extended life, all the stuff that you would want. They say the Spanish explorer Ponce de Leon in 1513 landed at St. Augustine and was looking for the Fountain of Youth. We know he never found it. He claimed the New World for Spain. But you know, there is no miracle drug that does that. It's not going to happen. But the scripture suggests that there is a grace for greater strength and for extended health and life. And you're probably too young to worry about that right now. But as you move through ministry and through life, you're going to discover that the charisma of God, the grace gifts of God, will carry you. And you don't have to push and you don't have to pull because of the strength of the Lord. It's an incredible mystery of science, the way God made the eagle. A mature eagle has 7,000 feathers made of keratin, the same thing that your hair and your fingernails are made of. The feathers comprise millions of interlocking microscopic structures that are light in weight but steel-like in strength. These layers of feathers actually trap the air, creating an insulation for the eagle from the cold and the rain. But you see, the eagle is a bird of prey. It only eats meat. It's a carnivore. So while on hunting expeditions, its feathers take terrible abuse. Every time it dives into the forest, its feathers are mangled and destroyed. And when it dives into waters and when it goes through rocky crags and cliffs. And so it is that over a period of 6 months, all of these feathers are shed. Until in the early spring, the eagle is totally restored. That is to say, in appearance, totally renewed. In this transformation process, the eagle is renewed so much so that it lives a very long age compared to other birds, 15 to 20 years. To actually quote a scientific article referring to this process, which was not a Christian article, it said, after which the eagle in his old age assumes the appearance of youth. So run and not be weary, walk and not faint. Mount up with wings as eagles. Consider the eagle, students, graduates now. Consider the eagle. Shed your feathers. Be willing to be lifted and carried in your life and in your ministry. It's okay. Shed sin. Shed bad habits. Shed pounds you don't want. Do Colossians 3:10. Put off the old man and let God put on the new man and renew you in the strength and the image of him who created you. Shed your feathers and let the strength of the Lord carry you. For the kingdom of God advances not by might, but by sight, and not by might, but by flight. And there is another characteristic of the eagle that Christian leaders must embrace. It has to do with where the eagle makes its home. When you read Job 39, it says, the eagle dwells on a cliff, a rocky crag is his stronghold. You see, the eagle selects the most inaccessible place it can find for its home, often thousands of feet above a valley floor, usually in very rough terrain, within a cliff or a rocky crag. One translator calls this stronghold a mountain castle. Here in the heights, it can spy out its food, and the young eaglets can catch the upward thermals and learn how to fly. Graduates, the kingdom of God advances not by might, but in the heights. Not by might, but in the heights. God created the eagle with an innate desire to ascend the heights and to soar alone. Its mountain castle is high. Its flight is high. And I speak both quantitatively and I speak qualitatively. When the eagle migrates, which is never in groups of more than 20 or 30 at a time, they actually fly a half a mile apart. Because you see, eagles fly alone. And this is prophetic of the solitary, sometimes lonely life of eagle leaders, for what God does in a man or a woman. You can be in the midst of a crowd. You can be in the midst of a local church or a church plant. You can be in a church family. You can be in a denomination or an organization. But there's something about the call of God and the destiny of Christ that keeps pulling you upward to this lonely, set-apart place in the heights, in the inner part of your most being, in an isolated place, in a place set apart, a place that the apostle calls heavenly places, seated with Christ, in a place where God sets you apart under his hand. It says in Genesis 32:24, and Jacob was left alone, and there he wrestled a man. In Exodus 24, and Moses alone shall come near to the Lord. Jeremiah 15:17, I did not sit in the assembly. I sat alone because of you. When I was in Bible college here in Eugene, Oregon, I would arise early in the morning when it was still dark, sometimes wet and rainy, oftentimes cold, and I would walk from Patterson Street, where our dorm was, which was a house, all the way to Olive Street downtown. I would skip breakfast. They trusted me with the key of the school. I'm not sure why they did that. And I would go into the prayer room down in the basement. I can still remember the sawdust furnace. And there alone, I discovered God. You'll have to find your own time. You'll have to find your own place. But I want to tell you this. Ministry in the valley with the multitudes depends upon and happens because of soaring alone in the heights, in that secret place hidden away with the Father. You see, the kingdom of God advances not because of might, but because of sight. Not because of might, but because of flight. Not because of might, but it happens in the heights. And one last characteristic. The sons of the eagle. The eagle clutches usually 1 to 3 eggs. Baby eaglets are in their nest for 9 to 11 weeks. It's the father eagle that provides all the basic necessities. In fact, just before the hatching of the eggs, and scientists don't know why this happens. I think I do. But the father eagle actually goes out and throws a baby shower. He brings back colored yarn. He brings back tin cans. He brings back tennis balls and golf balls and colored plastic and old shoes. I think it's because of the father's extravagant, outlandish, outrageous, unlimited, unconditional love for his sons. He just wants to lavish his favor on them. The father eagle is indispensable to the life. As the father has called and sent his son, Jesus Christ, it says in Hebrews 2:10, is bringing many sons to glory. Hebrews 5:8 says, though, that the way he learned that sonship was through suffering. The father eagle knows that the way to the crown is through the cross, but the little eaglet hasn't learned it yet. But the day comes when the handout is over. These baby eaglets have been fed. They've been provided everything they want in this plush little nest with leaves and down in the center of it. All the prickly limbs are hidden and all the prickly sticks are gone. But the day comes when the rite of passage is there. And the father eagle and the mother eagle begin by starving the children. They quit feeding them. And the little eaglets begin to get upset and they begin to get angry. And in time, they literally are famished, practically starving to death. And then, as the scripture says, they begin to stir up the nest. And by that, it means that they remove the down and they remove the leaves and everything that made the nest comfortable. And all of a sudden, these fat little baby eaglets that are becoming sleeker and more trim because they're not eating are required to stand up on their feeble little legs and walk around, and it's not soft. And then the father eagle begins with this fresh meat to encircle the nest and go around the outside of it, just 2 inches or so out of the reach of the baby eaglets. And their beaks and their talons reach out, but the father eagle makes sure they don't get any of it. And you know what happens, don't you? We all know what happens. I can't imagine that first free fall. It doesn't happen intentional, but that's what happens. They're up in the heights in this rocky crag, this mountain castle place, or the tops and the tips of the tree, and they begin to fall. I remember one of my first free falls as a son of God. Do you remember yours? You're famished, you're hungry, you're in a place of desperation. In this little eaglet's case, almost imminent death. Mustering all of his strength, he begins to flap his wings furiously, but with little success. He doesn't have enough sense to turn into the wind. Instinct says turn away from the wind, doesn't it? And so he falls to the ground in discouragement and desperation. And as death is imminent, the father eagle spreads his wings to catch the child and carries him on unfurled pinions back to the nest. This process doesn't happen just one time. This process happens over and over and over, falling and catching, over and over, till the eaglet either flies or dies. One article I read said 40% of the eaglets die. I'm sorry to report to you that I had Bible college friends, even roommates, who tried to fly and died. I don't know all of the reasons, but I can tell you as a denominational leader that pastors try to fly and die. The life in ministry can be fraught with disappointment and distress and discouragement. Somehow they miss this grand revelation that the road to the crown is through the cross, and that it's okay because at the last minute, that love affair that you have with the Father, that mentoring relationship of the Father, spiritual fathers and Father God, they're always going to be there to catch you. Always going to be there to catch you. Mature sons of God have learned to soar. They've learned how to walk on water. Mature sons of God, daughters of God, would rather be walking on the water than sitting in the boat. In fact, they'd rather be sinking in the water than sitting on the boat. And they know that if they lose their focus on Jesus, that he hasn't lost his grip on them. Sons and daughters of God have learned to obey when facing impossibility. Sons and daughters of God know that even in times of desperation and utter dependence on God, that they can learn to fly. And so on these turbulent, unpredictable thermals, they've learned to face the wind, unfurl their wings and be lifted, not flap them in wasted human effort. And out of a spirit of brokenness and emptiness, they begin to fly. They begin to soar. Graduates, consider the eagles. God has done more than anointed you for leadership. He's also appointed you to sonship. Your time of comfort and security in the nest has come, and God says, I'm stirring up the nest. Behold, now it's time to fly. You've seen the father model it. You've seen President Cadero model it. You've seen the faculty and your pastors model it. Now it's time to fly. For what are you waiting? He says, I'll lift you. I'll carry you. It's your destiny to soar higher, to mount up, to take flight on the dream, on the vision that God has given you, that he's put in your heart. You know where the edge is, don't you? I don't need to tell you. You know where the edge is. You know what that vision, what that word is, and it seems totally impossible to you right now. And the Lord is just saying, step to the edge. Step to the edge. Take flight on the dream and the vision that God put in your heart. For God will catch you and carry you on the pinions of his promises into ministry and into life. God bless you and congratulations.